Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and in today's video we will discuss techniques to increase the width of attached gingiva apical to gingival recession. We have already discussed free gingival graft, the classic technique, in my previous video, and in today's video we will discuss free connective tissue graft and apically positioned flap. The difference between free gingival graft and free connective tissue graft is the type of graft that is being utilized. That is, in free gingival graft, we used gingival graft which has both epithelium and connective tissue. But in free connective tissue graft, we use only connective tissue which has epithelium partly attached to it, that is while procuring the graft. This is the main difference between free gingival graft and free connective tissue graft. Now you may ask me, why connective tissue graft when we could manage with free gingival graft? The answer is, number one, connective tissue graft carries the genetic message which induces the overlying mucosa to differentiate into an epithelium, and second is better aesthetic outcomes with connective tissue grafts. That is why connective tissue grafts are preferred over gingival graft. Now, how to perform free connective tissue graft, we will discuss. The steps are same. The only difference is their execution. That is, recipient bed preparation, procuring the graft, transferring the graft, suturing it, and managing the palatal wound. But the differences are in each step. The outline is same. The surgical outline is same, but how to execute the surgery is totally different. So please pay attention. First step, recipient bed preparation. Let's say this is our tooth of concern. Clear? This is the lack of attached gingiva that we are going to address. So here the incisions given are as follows. Preserving the papilla, we give incisions, two horizontal incisions and a circular incision. This is the incision in terms of horizontal incisions given, okay? And the next incisions are vertical incisions. So these are the incisions to give you the outline of the recipient bed preparation. First, now talking in terms of the chronology of incisions, are first the vertical incisions are given, followed by second the horizontal incisions below the papilla. Please remember, please note here, there are few important points while preparing the recipient bed for connective tissue graft. The papilla has to be preserved in the first place, and the second point is these are partial thickness flap. Okay, so number one incisions are the vertical incisions, one on each side, followed by horizontal incisions below the interdental papilla, preserving the interdental papilla, and a circular incision. This is how, let me delineate it with a different color. The vertical incisions followed by horizontal incision. So this is the flap design, partial thickness. Remember to preserve the papilla, preserve the interdental papilla, and these are all partial thickness. Okay, these are the main points to remember while preparing the recipient bed. Clear? This is the flap design which has to be reflected. Again, partial thickness flap reflection. So it has to be very careful. Upon reflection, just hold the mucosal flap at the apical position. Please do not suture it, unlike in the case with free gingival graft. We are not intending to suture it apically. We are just keeping it apically, reflecting it, time being, till we transfer the connective tissue graft here. Okay, so let's say our recipient bed preparation is of such design. After reflection, let's say we have reflected our flap, mucosal flap. Let me be very clear, this is the mucosal flap, because as you can see, this is the mucogingival junction and this is alveolar mucosa. So this flap is reflected here. Clear? Mucosal flap. And now onto this side we will transfer the connective tissue graft. Next comes the second step, that is graft procurement. clear with the first step. It has to be with a 15 number blade, partial thickness flap reflection, two vertical incisions, one on the each side, followed by horizontal and circular incisions, preserving the interdental papilla. So this is the flap design which is reflected, and the reflected flap is a mucosal flap. Clear? Now talking about the second step, that is the most important step now, procuring the connective tissue graft. Yes, we are talking about connective tissue graft. So if this is the palate, again the palate is the donor site, and here the first difference is, unlike in the case with free gingival graft where we procured the graft from distal to the rugae, here the rugae should not hamper our graft procurement because we are concerned with connective tissue. So the rugae will not be a hindrance. If required, obviously we will try to procure it from the distal, that is molar region, corresponding to molar region, but if the site demands more connective tissue graft, then we may go anteriorly and involve the rugae, because ultimately we are gonna reflect the epithelial flap and collect the connective tissue graft from within and utilize the same. Clear? So please watch the second step very carefully. Here we are going to give first horizontal incision. The first horizontal incision is 5 to 6 mm from the gingival margin. One horizontal incision, again partial thickness. Everything is partial thickness as much as possible because it is favorable for healing. And here, because we are concerned with connective tissue graft procurement, it has to be partial thickness flap. So the first horizontal incision is a partial thickness flap, 5 to 6 mm from the gingival margin of the molars. And the second horizontal incision is somewhere 3 to 4 mm from the gingival margin. That is, this thickness of this epithelial collar should be 1 to 2 mm at least. Okay. So if we talk about the cross section, this is the epithelium, this is the connective tissue, and here is the bone. Okay. Clear? So our first incision is here, our second incision is somewhere here. Okay. Now we will give one vertical incision anteriorly, just because we want to separate this connective tissue graft from the epithelial graft. So there are two options in the step number 3. Step number 1 is 5 to 6 mm from gingival margin, horizontal incision, partial thickness. Step number 2 is again horizontal incision, partial thickness, 3 to 4 mm. So ultimately the graft thickness will be 1 to 2 mm. This epithelial collar kind of thing, which we will be able to take a grip of, will be 1 to 2 mm thick. Step number 3 is the vertical incision, optional. If you are comfortable with vertical incision, otherwise, as I've already mentioned, we can just extend the horizontal incision 1 to 2 teeth forwardly, that is anteriorly where there are rugae, because ultimately we are not going to collect rugae, we are not concerned with epithelium in this case, we are concerned with the underlying connective tissue graft. So there are two options in step number 3. Commonly we do give a vertical incision, or optionally if you are not comfortable or you don't prefer vertical incision, go for extending the same horizontal incisions 1 to 2 teeth anteriorly. So here we will give one horizontal incision. So if the horizontal incision is given, we will be able to reflect the flap. So this is how the flap will be reflected, and then this portion of the flap will be taken care of. So after giving this vertical incision anteriorly, step number 4 is reflection, partial thickness flap reflection. So go deep and reflect this epithelial portion of the flap, and with the second, that is a periosteal elevator, mind you, a tiny small periosteal elevator, reflect this second flap. Once the reflections are complete, then we need to give one similar horizontal incision at the base to separate this portion. This portion that looks like this. This is the epithelium, and here is the connective tissue portion. So after reflecting this flap, this epithelial portion flap, the first primary incision flap, Then we give a horizontal incision at the base parallel to the previous ones here, as you can see on this picture. I hope the pictures are clear and the concept is understood. I will repeat once again at the end of this summarization. Clear? So this connective tissue graft thus procured is then kept on a moistened gauze piece, and this flap reflected is now placed back and sutured. So here, unlike an open wound, we have a closed wound, which is by primary intention. Healing will take place by primary intention because we have brought back the flaps together and sutured it. So healing by primary intention. This is another advantage of reconnective tissue grafts. The donor site does not carry an open wound, which has a risk of acquiring infections. Clear? Now this connective tissue graft is then trimmed and adjusted as per the site and placed over it. So let's say we have placed our connective tissue over here, followed by covering it with this flap. Before covering it with this flap, this is the strap number 3. Before covering with this flap, the connective tissue itself is sutured first laterally, because we want to secure it in that position, followed by around the neck of the teeth, and then cover it with the mucosal flap that was reflected and held apically, which was reflected and held apically earlier. Now it is brought back and sutured here. Clear? This is how the procedure is executed. Here, if you have noticed, the palate does not carry any primarily the palate does not carry any open wound. It has got a sutured wound, which is closed wound, so healing will take place by primary intention. This is one advantage with free connective tissue graft. Let me quickly summarize this technique once again. Step number 1 is our recipient bed preparation, which consists of two vertical releasing incisions followed by horizontal and circular incision. This mucosal flap is reflected and held apically till the time we procure the graft and position it on the place. Second step is graft procurement. Now graft procurement, we have step number 1, a horizontal incision 5 to 6 mm from the gingival margin. Another horizontal parallel incision 3 to 4 mm from the gingival margin, followed by step number 3, a vertical incision so that we are able to procure the connective tissue graft that is separable from the primary incision flap. Clear? This is the step number 3, which is optional. Alternative to this vertical incision is we may extend our horizontal incisions 1 to 2 teeth anteriorly over the rugae, because here we are going to procure connective tissue graft, and so the rugae should not be a hindrance. These are the 3 steps of the incisions for graft procurement. So on the cross section it looks like incision number 1, incision number 2, and with the vertical incision, this flap is reflectable. So let's say our flap is reflected like this, and now we have this connective tissue graft. Clear? So now with the knife, the scalpel blade number 15, we reflect this primary incision flap, and with the periosteal elevator, tiny small periosteal elevator, over the second horizontal incision, we reflect this connective tissue graft. Okay? Sorry. The primary flap is reflected and the connective tissue is also separated from the periosteum and the bone. Now, once the reflections are complete, give a similar horizontal incision at the base so that this flap portion is separated from its primary flap. Once this flap is separated, now the picture will look like this. The flap here is taken out. Now close the flap. This flap is brought back to the original position and sutured. So the wound looks like closed wound which is sutured. So healing will take place by primary intention. This is the main difference between pre-gingival graft and connective tissue graft. Healing will take place by primary intention. This is the main advantage of connective tissue graft, apart from the previously mentioned 2 points. That is, it carries the genetic message for the overlying mucosa to differentiate into epithelium. Second is aesthetics, color match, and now the primary intention healing over the palatal wound site, that is the donor site. Clear? Once this graft is procured, we have to trim the graft and adjust it according to the recipient bed. Place the graft over the recipient bed and first suture it laterally to secure it in the place, followed by around the neck of the teeth, and followed by repositioning the flap back to the original position, that is covering this mucosal flap over the connective tissue graft, which will then, the connective tissue graft will induce this mucosa to differentiate into epithelium, and that is how we will get a new width of attached gingiva. So this is how connective tissue graft procurement and procedure is carried out. I hope this technique is clear to you all. Now we will discuss apically positioned flap. This technique is already discussed while we were discussing the surgical techniques for pocket elimination or pocket reduction, that is the flap technique. It is the same technique wherein we have already discussed in its advantages that while performing this flap surgical technique, we have an added advantage of increase in the width of attached gingiva. That is the same concept which we discuss here. Here, while performing apically positioned flap, the first thing to keep in mind is adequate vestibular depth. Yes. For performing apically positioned flap, vestibular depth has to be adequate as a prerequisite. Otherwise, this technique cannot be performed. And the second consideration is the position of the flap in relation to the crest of the bone. Clear? While positioning the flap, of course, it is positioned apically, but then there are three ways possible, that is three positions possible, although apically. The first position is covering the crest of the bone. It is in relation to the crest of the bone. This is the flap and bone. Clear? So here, when this technique is performed, we have three possible positions. One is covering the crest of the bone. Another one is at the crest of the bone, and the third one is 2 mm short of crest of the bone. See, the first option, that is covering the crest of the bone, although an option, but is not a good option, because here by covering the crest of the bone, we always keep a scope of pocketing, that is further disease activity reinitiation or recurrence. That is why covering the crest of the bone while apically positioning the flap is not a good option. Second and third option, that is at the crest of the bone or 2 mm short of the crest of the bone. Talking about at the crest of the bone is a good option given the contours are marginally correct, that is adequately thinning the margin of the flaps. Clear? If adequate thinning of the flap margins are performed, then the second option is viable, that is positioning at the crest of the alveolar bone. In this way, the bone loss that could take place by exposing the bone will not take place. This is an advantage with the second option, that is placing the margins of the flap at the crest of the bone. And the third option is 2 mm short of the crest of the bone. That means we are exposing the bony margins. Yes, bony margins are exposed and it will become converted in the due course of time into bone loss. That is, the marginal bone loss will take place due to the bone exposed, that is the bone exposed kept by keeping the margins 2 mm short of the bone crest. Clear? But in that way, the marginal contours that will be achieved will be ideal. So, out of the three options in apically positioning the flap, the position of the flap apically covering the crest of the bone, at the crest of the bone, or 2 mm short of the crest of the bone. Second and third options are better than the first one. The first one is actually not at all an option to be considered. So this is all about apically positioning of the flap, wherein increase in the width of attached gingiva is achieved by this surgical technique. So this is how we have covered free gingival graft, the classic technique in my previous video, free connective tissue graft, and apically positioning of the flap in today's video, and thus the topic technique to increase the attached gingiva apically. Please remember, we are still discussing techniques to increase the width of attached gingiva apically to the gingival recession. The three main techniques in this categorization category is completed. Now, in the next video, we will discuss techniques to increase the attached gingiva coronal to the gingival recession. That is, we will attempt root coverage also. Clear? I hope this topic, technique to increase the width of attached gingiva apical to the gingival recession, is now clear. All the three techniques, free gingival graft, free connective tissue graft, and apically positioning of the flap. I hope the topic is clear, but if you still have any doubts or any queries, please ask me in the comment section below or mail me at my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day. Stay safe.